This is Paul Naton of Radiocarbon Art Productions, and in celebration of the 25th edition of the International Hand Launch Glider Festival, I'm posting my documentary film on the event on YouTube for the world to enjoy. It's been 18 long years since pro cameraman Dave Reese and I made this film covering the Torrey Pines Gull's long-running HLG contest, and it's really fun to compare today's designs with the gliders we were flying back in 2000. In fact, this contest was the last one to use the javelin launch technique, and you can see in the film a few pioneering competitors tip launching the first DLG designs. By next year's contest, nearly every pilot had changed over to the discus launch technique, and the hand launch glider took a giant design leap forward. Support this free film viewing by visiting my website at radiocarbonart.com. And check out my collection of professionally produced how-to and training video programs on building, preparing, and flying today's RC gliders. Enjoy the film. Gliders represent the purest form of RC soaring, using only the pilot's throwing power for launch and his flying skills to catch the thermals which keep the plane aloft. Every summer, over 80 hand launch glider maniacs gather for the Torrey Pines Gull's International Hand Launch Festival. This annual contest takes place the first week of June at the club's thermal field just north of San Diego, California. Though open to all pilots, this contest attracts the very best competition flyers from the U.S. and other countries around the globe. Every pilot must fly 10 rounds of flying tasks over the 2 days, which test both his plane handling and thermal duration abilities. Each round has a flying task pre-assigned and a set flight time window, usually between 8 and 10 minutes, in which the pilot has to complete the task. Some rounds allow for an unlimited amount of throws, while others limit the amount of throws and the time allowed. Because there are so many pilots and a limited amount of radio frequencies, each task round is divided into many heats, and the pilots are only scored against others in the same heat to make sure changing conditions do not favor one heat over another. Say the heat calls for the pilot to complete 5 2-minute flights within a 10-minute flight window. A perfect task would be 5 2-minute flights, though this is impossible as it takes a few seconds to catch and rethrow the plane. The pilot with the highest total flight times wins the heat and receives 1,000 points, and the rest receive a normalized score based on his total flight times. A pilot's total score of 10 rounds over 2 days counts towards the flyoffs. At the end of 2 days of flying, the top 10 pilots then fly against each other in 3 more rounds to determine a new champion. All the weekend scores transfer to the fly-offs, so a pilot can either gain or lose positions in the last 3 rounds. You have been watching Joe Wirtz, who has won the International 5 times, and he's the guy the others are trying to beat. The planes can be constructed of any lightweight material, and though there is no minimum or maximum weight, the wingspan of the plane is limited to 59 inches or 1.5 meters. Most of the current contest planes are made of fiberglass, carbon fiber, Kevlar, balsa wood, and epoxy resins. Each plane carries a radio receiver, battery pack, and servos to control the flight surfaces. Today's contest planes weigh as little as 6 ounces, though most weigh between 8 and 10 ounces. Most pilots have 2 to 3 gliders, each designed for different conditions, such as weak lift or strong winds. An automated countdown system tells the pilots how much time is left in the heat. Paul Anderson is one of the hot young pilots trying to win this year's contest.
7 minutes.
4 minutes. 9, 8.
He has superb launching and thermaling technique.
4, 3, 2, 1.
He is flying a Feather XL from Raptor Aerosports. Any pilot over 55 years old can fly in the Eagle class. The older guys may not throw as high as some of the young hotshots, but they can sure fly as well. In the morning, when the lift is weak, the tasks are shorter, emphasizing good plane handling instead of long flight times. As the thermals get going at mid-morning, the flight times become longer, emphasizing thermaling technique and strategy. Each pilot flies the round with a timer who keeps track of flight times, but who also serves as a second pair of eyes to help the pilot with finding lift.
I'm watching 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, clear. I don't see anything up there. Good job.
The power lines on the south edge of the field were always ready to snag the careless pilot.
Fired up.
Good.
Nope. Yeah.
Yep. Got it.
Perfect.
Good catch, Paul.
Now this airplane is a prototype to a successor for the Encore, four servo airplane built in the Encore tradition with the Kevlar skins, carbon spar, a little bit slight evolution since it's a pod and boom, using a fairly expensive type boom, which has an aluminum sheath and carbon inside, very, very stiff tube, so that you don't have the boom flex and whip problems that seem to be endemic to a lot of the pod and boom designs out today. These airplanes are being built by Phil Pearson he's working with Don Peters and Maple Leaf. The guy's a craftsman. Anybody can build an airplane ready to go. Four servos, about 8.3 ounces. The guy's and clean. Definitely two thumbs up for the airplane. Airplane's using an airfoil that I designed for use in conjunction with trailing edge. It uses just a 1 to 2 degrees of reflex for very fast flight, diving upwind and such. Medium cruise, it's neutral, and thermal, it's using about 2 to 4 degrees of trailing edge down to get the minimum sink rate. Airplane lives up to my expectations, which probably fairly high, so I'm quite pleased with the toy. and we'll see how it does at the Poway contest.
Hi, I'm Brett Baldy.
And I'm Jim Carlton. We're from Cleveland, Ohio, the north coast, if you will, of the country. And I've got a little homebrew plane that I'm flying here and trying to keep up with these hot shots here on the west coast. We're having fun. Brett designed this and is working on a different kind of addition to the flying that we've been doing. I'll let him explain a little bit about it.
Yeah, we've both been flying Monarch D, so we kind of progressed from that, and Monarch D plan form, playing around with different airfoils, and been experimenting with different tail boom lengths and tail area volumes. We're making up our own fuselages, carbon fiber, Kevlar, cutting our own cores. A lot of this is, we just enjoy doing our own thing and learning from everybody, and part of the fun of it is out here watching what other guys are doing and learning and enjoying the time. So,
been a real challenge. But it's fun to have a plane that you can rely a little bit on, which is something I haven't had that luxury of lately. So it's fun. It's a real challenge. Hand launch is the way to go.
Okay, what we've done for control surfaces here are used Hitech's, the newer HS55s, a little bit more torque than the HS50s, and about the same size case. Works really well. We're using a Berg 6-channel receiver, I believe it is, without the case to cut down on the weight. And I'm running this with a little 3-cell pack, 150 milliamp. So I get some good flying times. 35, 40 minutes is no problem. And wire push rods, real happy with the control linkage. It works real good. And reliability has been very good on the receiver and such.
Jim Carlton, let us put a microphone on him so you can get a feel for what it's like to fly a heat.
Come to the other guy, man on man. See what we can do. Come on, a little bit. Smooth. That's it.
Yeah, right in there.
Okay, good.
That's 20.
1 minute. Right? 8 1-minutes.
1 minute.
Boy, this ground is rough back here.
Okay, let's run over to the corner and use it twice. Okay. 25.
Yep. I'm coming down the hard way. Smooth. Keep it smooth. Yep. Keep it smooth.
Okay. You're up to 25 seconds.
Okay.
Looking good.
I'll move out this way a little bit.
35.
Give me some room to land. Keep it in here.
40 seconds. Got another 20 you need.
Okay. I'm a huffing.
Scope out the air up ahead.
Yeah.
Like you
see what's back up there to your left.
50 seconds.
10 seconds. Okay. Up here.
6 minutes.
60.
Here we go. See who's in front of me.
45.
See what kind of launch we can get here. Heads up. Heads up.
Okay,
What do you see behind you? Anything? Down. Okay. What we got up here to the left? Oh, that was nothing. Okay, let's keep it smooth. I don't know if we can come and back into that again. Okay. Okay. Where'd that guy just go that he launched? Which way? Which way? Yeah. See anything? See anything? Hold. Straight out.
1 minute 30 seconds.
Try this one. Yep. There it is. Up. It's back to my right. Thirty, oh no. Ah! Ah! Hover, baby, hover, hover mode. Okay. Right back up. Ah! Oh, that wasn't good. That was no good. Same air. Ah, rats. Yep. It's old and fat, guys. I'm off. Thanks, Brett. Okay, good job timing. Appreciate it. Woo, this California sun is hot. It certainly is. Okay. Some good, some not so good. Some work, a lot of fun, I'm telling ya. I just need to get in shape. This is rough work. But can't be beat, hand launch is great.
The Austrians were experimenting with a new discus launch technique developed by the Americans to improve launch height.
1 minute, 30 seconds.
This technique would soon revolutionize hand launch, making the normal javelin launch obsolete.
This is a Chinook. It's kitted by a company called Thermal Grommet Works out of Seattle, Washington. My name is Ryan Wittenberg. The kit manufacturer is a friend of mine from college. I decided to purchase a couple of these off of him. I really fell in love with them, and they fit very nice in an overhead compartment. So far I haven't done exceptionally well, but it's a lot of fun anyways.
Here are some of the best pilots launching in slow motion so you can learn to throw like an expert. If you had to land outside the field boundaries, your flight does not count, and many had to make the run of shame to recover their gliders. A small hill well outside the field boundary could be sloped for some extra flight time, but many ended up crashing into the sage bushes. This pilot did a great job squeezing every last second out of his flight. Paul Anderson makes a nice save, landing just inside the field boundary. Listen in as top pilot Paul Naton flies and wins his heat flying a modified Flamingo.
Center field's happening a little bit. You got anything?
Not really.
Center field, there's a guy. Yeah, it's okay, but it's nothing to write to mommy about.
It's going to hang.
Just do what you're doing, man. Just kind of cruise it.
Yeah.
Surf. You need a couple minutes. Fast turnaround is critical, Paul. So
yeah.
See, man, you got a minute and a half to work this. Recommend if you sky that you go upwind and scout with about 40 remaining.
Yeah. That's nice air.
Yeah, it's good.
Just fly like back home.
Yeah, it's nice to be the top guy, too, because then nobody can hit you.
Yeah.
Well, you got company coming your way that's probably as high. That's right. So you've got 58 remaining.
This thermal's going to be too far back shortly.
Yeah. 45 remaining. It's a nice air. Very nice air.
You need to do something like that, by the way.
Yeah, start coming home here.
Yeah. I see a dandelion floating by that's moving really fast.
Get a clear spot here. Some air over there.
13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. That was perfect, Paul.
Right in the sink, though.
Okay, there's let me watch. Oh, man. Drillage.
Yeah.
There's a guy coming to you with altitude, but he's pounding the whole way there. The field is pounding right now.
Okay, it's going to surf it out.
I think, yeah, surf as long as you can, and then when you when you re-throw, let's go straight up the ground. Nothing happens. Stretching.
There's a nice surf.
You're at 38 seconds right here.
You can run over there.
So as long as you can, you're at 45. Lower?
You have four throws remaining in about two minutes and a couple seconds to go.
Gonna be gone shortly.
You're spec, man. Okay, you got a minute and four to go. Okay. I might recommend going upwind and sniffing it out.
Yeah.
Okay, there's something. Well, there's something popping up.
Well, I was saying.
Yeah.
I'm coming back.
Okay, there's several guys upwind, so let me just check it out for you. You got 50 to go.
I'm snooping. I'm coming back upwind here. It's looking good. I got some heavy pull to my left.
I would say that's the solution right now. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now remember, you don't have to max this. You still have, but your turnaround is critical, of course. But
yeah.
Yeah, there should be like just a little over 2 minutes remaining in the round. So
yeah, there we go.
Probably gonna need one more throw after this if you max.
Remind me next time we're back.
Right in front of you. There it is. Three corn upwind, Paul.
Okay.
The yellow
coming
guy,
up.
The yellow airplane coming to you is definitely got a nice patch.
Yeah, there we go.
That should, yeah, there you go. Nice job. A little over a minute to go.
Okay.
And there's another one coming down the gully.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a nice thermal coming down. It's out of ways, but it's good.
Okay. This one's starting to fall apart a little bit.
We got 55 to go.
Good move, Tom.
All right.
Nice flying, dude.
That's good. Wow,
great. So you
that was a little stressed.
Well,
We have some good air.
45.
A couple of suckers and a couple of tears.
738 total.
That's pretty good.
Nice job, yeah. Yeah, first good turnaround. That's how it's done, folks. Woohoo! So who's up next?
Well, the key was fast relights and surfing downwind of everybody. Seemed like everyone was kind of staying upwind too much and went down a few times and got pretty lucky there. Sunday was hot again, and Dick Barker was getting 55-mile-an-hour launches. A couple of the guys were dressed in the latest hand launch contest fashions, and this guy had a pair of the latest in thermal detection glasses from a secret Soviet lab. With so many good pilots, it's an accomplishment to make page one of the standings.
Wolfgang Zach, and this is my glider developed last winter. I have a special carbon tube made by pre-break inside and hot epoxy. It's very light and very stiff for side arm launch. I have two wires and one rubber for making rudder to the left and elevator up, and the wires contraverse. Don't change the direction, it's important so. Then you see a 5-servo butterfly glider, so I can give down the flap for butterfly and camber change. And if butterfly goes down very far, it opens here and closes. And this is only the speed attack against fluttering. Here you see normal servos at the backer receiver. Only one condensator for making enough electric for the moment, and the flaps are on the upside round, downside is only one tape. Normal 9mm servos inside, and this is the hook for sidearm launch. I grip in with my fingers, throw it out, and when I go out it's nearly a good airfoil again. This is only to make it's tight, always each rudder is working on this small ball, and I think that's my finger point looking up through the rubber. When I go out, it's flat again. I think that is it.
Twenty-three, twenty-four, twenty-five, twenty-six, twenty-seven, twenty-eight. 29 und 30 brauchst.
Computers keep track of the hundreds of scores.
Well, this is the scoring program that we enter information, pilot number, 30. Heat and round numbers, and we start entering all the times in minutes and seconds for 25. Every pilot. And then we simply come on the screen, we can send, 20, recalculate the 19, scores. 18, and 17, then we can print 15, out the contrast report 15, between all the rounds 14, and all the pilots 13, can know where they stand.
12,
sometimes 11, they're happy, sometimes they're 10, sad.
9, 8,
go
seven,
figure, huh?
Six, go figure.
5, 4. Those with poor depth perception often landed in the tall eucalyptus trees near the south boundary.
Trying to light stuff until I absolutely have to go over and get gassed up.
Hi, I'm Nobusuke Tokunaga from Japan. They call me Buzz. So I got my airplane. So this is just usual poly ship, but this is monarch wing, the both wing, the tails. But this, I just changed a little thing, like this is my own design, fuselage. I just changed the incidence and the decollage and the, you know, moments. And I feel much better. I fly really good today too. So.
3 minutes.
And what's the weight on that, Buzz?
Oh, I think it's a 8 or 9. I think it's. I should put some more weight though. So because this condition here, it's windier and that's windier than I thought. So I feel much better today though.
All right.
You can start walking, Buzz, if you want a better read on your plane. And, you know, we can get closer.
All right.
I don't know where Buzz is. Oh, I see him right there turning. Oh,
right.
He's a great Eric. No, Buzz, just keep doing that.
I know. That's too easy.
Relax, Derek. Yeah. No, he's got. No, Buzz got. No, you're the man now. You're the best, Derek. Yeah, you can feel good now. This is the part you just have fun. You start thinking now, well, I do a rolling circle for outside loop. What do I do?
You get to enjoy the monarch.
Well, that's the reward.
That's the reward for running.
7, 8, 9, 10,
8, 9, 10. Okay?
Yes, it was okay. 602.
Oh, perfect.
Well, looks okay though. I had a great time. God, I got maybe 1,000?
Well, except for the 15 seconds.
Right.
Not much.
Not too bad, too.
Yeah. Good job.
Thanks a lot.
Respect it out, man.
Thanks, sir.
Kick him right.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
I'm Matt Gawain with composite store CST, and this model is an original design. It uses a quarter inch carbon tube for a spar and some small carbon rods for leading edge and trailing edge, and the ribs are balsa wood capped with carbon to make them stiffer, and the covering material is called polyspan. It's a polyester tissue, kind of like Tyvek. Envelopes are made out of, only it's lighter, and then it's painted with a clear dope with some pigment in it to make it bright colors. Let's see, the pod is molded out of Kevlar, and again with pigment in it, and the epoxy, and the tail boom is an aluminum carbon aluminum boom that we import from Europe. It's a real light poly model. It likes the early morning rounds, but it doesn't like the afternoon rounds very well.
1 minute.
What's your all-up weight there, Matt?
Oh, it's about comes out about 8 ounces.
Any chance of taking a look on the inside, or is that...
Oh, there's not much to see on the inside.
Oh, okay.
We can open it up. Just a couple servos and a receiver stuffed in there.
That got out.
One guy got a max, maybe.
Well, he's the guy that's gonna hurt everybody.
I would say.
But you're gonna be right behind him.
Well, if all I can hope for is that the whole place shuts down now and he can't rehook up either.
And he's gonna max out of this, he'll be even.
Artie took a chance on a small thermal, but landed way off field.
Out of last place. I don't care if it kills me. The poor guy above me is better look out. Because I'm coming back. I got to get 300 points and I'm going to do it.
You got to gain 300 points.
I got to gain 300. I'm in last place.
That's it.
Go kill him.
All right.
Thank you.
Four, three.
This is Jason trying to come from 60th to 59th place.
Stay with it.
Okay,
stay
at this
with
point,
it.
I'm going straight, right?
Yep, just keep going straight. You got nothing to lose. Nothing to lose. Looking good. Looking good. Keep it smooth. There you go. Good job. Good job. You got good time on this one, bud.
Way better than the other rounds.
You got good time on this one. You bet.
Good calling, man.
There you go, Jay.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you, Rod.
How'd it feel to take that one out, huh?
Oh, that's a first.
That was gone. Woo! 1 minute. That's for us beginners. That's a lot.
afraid. I feel like I came to this thinking I know what it's about. I thought maybe because I can fly slow, power plane and gliders, other places, I thought I could do this. This is a lot harder than it looks. But the best thing about it is the people are nice. It's hard. It's a challenge. I'm going to keep doing it until I get out of last place. Maybe next year.
Techniques. How much lead? Oh, God, I'm scared. Jeez, it's going to be too heavy.
Yeah, I noticed all the hot hand launch guys have some sort of wrap on their one leg.
Just this crippled one.
Everyone used to ride motorcycles? Jeez, what the hell is it?
In the afternoon, the wind usually picks up, giving an advantage to heavier planes, which can better penetrate upwind from fast-moving thermals. A pilot can add lead ballast to a lighter plane to make it fly faster in the afternoon sea breezes.
We'd like to hear the strategy.
Some buoyancy. Buoyancy right.
Wait for about a minute and a half and then throw it for desperation. Everybody's going!
Yeah, well, the one up front marks some buoyancy. Now they're all figured out.
There's nothing! Nothing there. Tackled it.
That's your big flight of the day, big boy.
That's my big flight.
That's your big flight of the day, 51 seconds. And an off-field. Of course, you got to have the off-field to get your picture off-field. Yeah. Thanks, Mark. No, I'm the man. Here we go. Is this for three?
30.
Yeah, is this for three?
It. Yes.
Thank you.
He's the man, he said. 25. But he was the screw.
Okay, what do I do? I got a hook. Hook. 19, hook. Upwind.
18. Gordon, I'm watching the stopwatch. 8.
Yeah. Center field?
I'm gonna go downwind if you got the man, center field.
That's your ear. Take your one, you got 40.
He already has the one, doesn't he?
No, he doesn't. He's got four and three. You got 45.
What's happening there? Nice call, you guys. Very nice call. Very nice call.
Bird kind of helped.
Very hasty.
Go that
hey,
way.
What do I need, seconds. Mark? 30 seconds. Okay, I'm going to try to throw it again.
No, you aren't. You only need a minute.
Well,
yeah. Kind of gave up on that last flight, unfortunately.
A good heave would have been good for probably another 10 or 15 seconds on that last flight.
Should have thrown it hard.
Should have thrown it hard. Just drove up with
everyone that I saw that was launching down here and trying to get into something, they could get blown back behind the line. And
so, will they fall in the riverbank down?
Yeah, the one guy was up here on this end. So, I would say that the push, regardless of where you go, I would say to go up to the front end of the field.
Let's do it about center field.
Okay.
All right, is everybody ready?
You're flying the plane.
I'm David Griffin from New Zealand. It's right down in the South Pacific. I'm flying simply the best made in Eastern Europe. It's a neat little airplane. The fuselage is molded gel coat and Kevlar carbon. Leading edge of this is molded Kevlar. And then you can see it's a D-box section with balsa ribs inside it. And then balsa ribs capped in carbon and a carbon trailing edge. But the only weak point of it's the tailplane, which is balsa and carbon, but it's got a bit of a weak point through there. But it's a good airplane. It doesn't launch as high as most of the ones here. It suffers in the wind, but it's pretty maneuverable, so I've been able to ride out in some of the thermals pretty well.
Flying in this demanding contest can be strenuous, and most pilots had sore legs and arms by the end of the weekend. If you get injured, you can have someone else toss your plane for you.
Good tip on hammock. When you come into a crosswind, always turn downwind because you don't want to move in front of you.
All right, yeah.
The top 10 guys after the regular rounds go on to the fly-offs. The Torrey Pines Gulls always have some fine trophies for the top competitors. A brush fire broke out in the windy, hot conditions, making for an eerie backdrop to the final three fly-off rounds. The fly-offs usually get underway late in the afternoon when the thermals are dying down, making the last three rounds very challenging. Making one mistake can cost a pilot many places, but flying well can really move you up in the standings.
No, you gotta get this.
Oh, we're kind of on videotape.
See, that's part of the secret toss trick. Take a swig and.
Hey, yeah. It's the U.S. Hey. Team beer, man.
Yeah, I landed off field once.
Oh, that hurt.
So, you know, more and more. Cool, I didn't drop much to you then.
No.
So everybody else, I think.
As the years go by, there's just more human side to you.
Arthur, when's
I suck.
When's that today
I don't suck. It's just I suck less than most people sometimes.
Okay, we got to start thinking. I can't. One more of those and Mike Fox is beating my butt.
Well, if you even, I think, you get
3 minutes before I get too much, Joe.
I gave up 200 points.
Oh. Whoops. Okay.
15 seconds for
the visit. All right, well, we'll get that anyway, okay?
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2,
other guys. You gotta watch other guys. See?
You're in
the hill now. People are coming back.
Fire.
got plenty of thrust.
What is this?
I don't understand.
The final standings in 10th place, Mike Fox. 9th place, John Erickson. 8th place, Paul Anderson. 7th place, Brand Lugo. 6th place, Wolfgang Seck. 5th place, Noel Siegel. 4th place, Paul Naton. 3rd place, Greg Nosworthy. 2nd place, Arthur Markiewicz.
One of these days he's going to get tired and go away, so the rest of us might have a chance.
Never!
11, 7, 22, 87. First place, go words.
Excellent contest.
Thank you. Here's a little something for the wall.
Wait a minute.
That's a guy who comes prepared.
Yeah, all right. Wow. Let's see.
Talk a lot. Okay, can we get everybody up here for a picture, please?
Woo!
All right. Good job, Joe.
Oh, thanks.
Really.
Great contest.
Thank you.
As always, you guys put on a good contest.
Good. Yeah, we love doing it.
Flying hand launch gliders is a great way to improve your flying skills. After you have mastered the basics, I hope you can come out and test your skills against the best at the next International Hand Launch Festival.
Hi, I'm Dick Barker, and this is an uplink. I'm not sure exactly how things got started, but in 1998, they were flying the little tip launch planes here, Harold Locke, Phil Pearson, and Adam Weston, which basically were 40 inch or less, and you launch them underhand like that. And they went straight up an amazingly high distance compared to a Javelin launch. Unfortunately, they also came down a little bit faster because of the short span and were not really competitive except in very, you know, strange circumstances like real tiny thermals. They could turn tight and they'd work fine for that. But to just outlast a full-size hand launch glider on a normal day, they couldn't do it. I decided that if you were to grab a tip of a regular plane, a full meter and a half, and spin around and release it, you could do amazing barrel rolls when you let go because one wing was moving twice as fast as the other. Enough rudder offset made that go away, so with a modern computer radio, it's real easy to preset things to where they need to be to get a straight launch if you turn the preset off at the right time. Since then, a lot of people have gone to gyros rather than the rudder offset, but the main thing is the flat 360 launch builds up a tremendous amount of velocity, and you get the launch height that they were getting with the underhand tossed small planes, but you've got the sustaining power of a full-size plane. And it worked quite well. This is basically the plane I developed in 88 or 98, except that when I started out, they would break maybe once out of every 10 launches, something would happen. The tail would blow off, or a wing would crease, or a tail boom would break, or something. The real problem is sort of finding out what happened first when you launch it and it does this rapid disassembly in the air about 15 feet in front of you. Gradually, things got to where they don't break anymore. And I can comfortably fly a plane every day for 6 months now and not have it too badly broken up. The wing on this is a little different than what all the other people are using for discus launch, in that there's no carbon in it at all. I have a glass shear web that runs through this section and then a spar cap on the top and bottom of glass. Glass is so much easier to work with than carbon, and I'm basically lazy, so I would prefer to not put both the time and the expense of the carbon into the wing. And I can get a wing that's within a couple of tenths of an ounce of the carbon wings and have it just as durable for the loads that I impose on it. It makes the cost of building a wing far cheaper than if you're using carbon and Kevlar. The Kevlar has nice dent resistance, but I'd rather just build another wing when things get really beat up. On mine, I use a bulkhead here with two CS20 servos behind it. Right in front of that is a 555 receiver that sits upright between the bulkhead and the square battery pack, the 110mm NiCad or 270mm nickel metal hydride. With the receiver upright in this position, it's real easy to take the hatch off. The crystal's right there. You could pull it out and put another one in. The other thing that's a little different on this is in the tail, I use a stainless steel 022 rod that goes through a little piece of yellow nylon tubing to get from the carbon push rod up to the elevator. And then there's a little pivot here with a piece of aluminum tubing and an L bracket of 032 steel. The rudder is the simple 032 steel transition from the carbon pushrod, fiberglass G10 glass horn, and a bent aluminum thingy to hook it up. That's about all that's different from what you saw from Phil. I'm not as meticulous as he is on the peg. I poke a hole with an awl, ream it out with a taper reamer to the right size, harden it a little bit with some foam-friendly CA, and shove the peg in with some epoxy, and have a disc of 3-ounce glass that's about 1.25 inches in diameter on both sides to hold it. Again, the web of your finger can really get cut up if this is not perfectly smooth or if you've mounted the peg too far in. If you mount the peg in the right place, you can support it with your thumb. Have your pads of your fingers on the thing rather than up here. If you have it up here, you're going to hook the thing to where you can't release it when you want to. The only other thing I'd like to cover is a couple of little hints on launching. That's, you've got a given amount of energy when you release the thing, but you can play a lot of funny games with what you do with that energy. Sometimes you want to get all the altitude you can, so a launch that transitions to almost a 90 degree climb will do the best for you. Other times you want to get way over there. And I have a launch preset that puts in a little bit of up elevator, but I have another switch that I use to put in a little bit of down when I'm trying to get through a piece of sink in a hurry. I can use that switch also on the launch, and if I want to get way over there, I leave the switch in the speed position and the plane goes closer to the horizon, but still climbs reasonably well. Now, sometimes you don't want to do that. You want to be as high as you can, as quick as you can. And the best way to do that, of course, is to launch pretty much vertically. So without the speed switch, things work a little bit different. So you have your option of distance or height. And part of the strategy of flying is which you're going to use for any given time. Now, the other thing with this is there's a very small amount of polyhedral compared to other planes. So you may have noticed when it was flying, it skids a little bit getting into the turn. I considered that a pretty good trade-off in terms of having the strength at the joint by not having too much and still allowing it to turn well enough to do the job. The gyro in here, if you notice when I turn the plane, the rudder goes the same direction I'm waving the tail, and that corrects the launch and avoids the need for rudder offset during the launch.
Discus, or sidearm launching, has quickly become the preferred way to launch for the contest and recreational flyer. Hand launch pioneer Phil Pearson explains how to launch using this method.
I'm Phil Pearson, and this is the Seattle Soaring Area Soaring Society Northwest Regional Contest. Paul's up here from Oregon to pick up a few tips on discus launching and maybe discuss the history of discus. I know it a few areas, fellas were flying and discus launching or side launching airplanes before, but I think really this area is the beginning of what we call the side launch. And a friend of mine, Harold Locke, started this years ago because it was difficult for him to throw overhand. And Harold and I flew virtually every day during the week for many years as he developed the launch. Some of the earlier launches, I remember, were quite comical because when we'd share the airplane, people would laugh so hard at it that they just literally roll on the ground. But it took a long time for him to get the launch up. It showed promise early, and the early models were basically balsa wood over white foam. Harold liked to build them very, very light. They were low aspect ratio and about a 40-inch span, because with a 270-degree launch, that was about all of the weight that he could handle with his arm. To give you an idea of how high the velocities were, every once in a while he'd hit a weed with a wingtip, and it'd blow up like dropping a large light bulb on the ground. So it showed promise very, very early, and it was very difficult to beat the early planes. I think the idea originated when my wife and I were down in Monterey at Sand City, and we saw a fella down there launching a small slope plane called a Silhouette. He'd fly over to about a 35-foot high sand dune, slope for a while, roll it inverted, make a big turn around him, come back in and catch it, and throw it up again, do a roll on the way up. So when we got back home, I mentioned to Harold something about the idea of a hand-launch aerobatic class. About 2-3 weeks later, he came out with an aileron version, flat-winged and sweat-backed, in order to gain the stability. It was a long time before we could throw a dihedral or polyhedral airplane because of the coupled yaw turn, of the airplane. I was experimenting at that time with what is now known as the X-tail, using a sub-rudder to counteract the initial adverse yaw of a polyhedral in the turn. And Harold immediately recognized that the sub-rudder would cancel out the torque forces on the tail of the side launch. So one afternoon after a contest here, he pulled a polyhedral out with this X-tail on it, and I proceeded to try and beat him for about 3 hours. And the only time that I could actually tie him was when we both got lift, and it became a moot point at that time. And at that point, I knew that javelin throwing was basically over with. One of the early problems that we had, the planes were basically fairly low aspect ratio and short span, so it was very difficult to reach the performance of a 60-inch glider, and in fact impossible, mathematically impossible. So Dick Barker decided to retire and developed the 360-degree discus launch, and that popularized the throwing of the 60-inch airplanes. 1997, I flew the short span planes at Poway, and the Europeans converged on me and brought the information home, and it caught on big in Germany, and in fact it's been called the Seattle disease in Germany for some time. Now, of course, everybody seems to have caught on to it, and I think that once you try it, you'll realize that even for informal flying, it's a far superior method to launch a hand-launch glider. And in fact, it's allowing a lot of older people and people with arms that are injured to throw planes even higher than some of the highest javelin launchers of several years ago. This is an original polyhedral by Tim Johnson that somewhat typifies the earlier short span hand launch. Now Tim's gone to an even higher aspect ratio, but one of the problems that's come up in the design of a polyhedral is that there's tremendous compression loads on the bottom of the joint out here, the wing, and the skin tends to lift off of the foam in this area. And what's happening is that people are starting to use less equivalent dihedral and more joints to equalize this loading that's building up in this area and to minimize the compressive problems. So as a result, the first generation discus launch airplanes have a little less spiral stability. They're a little more difficult to turn than what some of us would like. I think that spars and maybe perhaps something like a spar, that is a higher density foam, blue foam or something in pink underneath the carbon fiber, will probably solve this, or maybe even extremely high density foams such as the 60 PSI Dow blue foam. It seems to be somewhat readily available. Now the other planes, such as this Encore, that are dihedral, generally don't have that problem. But you run into another problem with these planes, and that is you have a stress riser at the end of the ailerons. And if these planes are to be launched without a wingtip pin, which the Germans contributed, it's a great idea, then the wing tends to fail right at your at your fingertips, and it'll generally fail in compression on top. So the spar is really important here, or higher density foams, some sort of reinforcement in the front. Now, if you use the pin, the reinforcement isn't quite as important. Discus launch airplanes have to go from virtually zero to over 100 miles per hour and a rotation of, say, 270 degrees or so, maybe 300 degrees. So there's tremendous inertial forces because of that rotation, and it's very important that the wing be fastened onto the fuselage properly with larger bolts. Now, this fuselage, we're getting away with it with a 440 for the aft hold down, but we've got wide flanges here and the wings are taped on. Most wings are actually taped on. So I think that if you can tape it, that's a good idea, or you can use larger bolts to hold it on. The pin is held with the pad of the fingers, not the joint. It's due to the inertial forces. It's very difficult to let go of the plane if you hold it in these joints. So by holding it with the pad, you can let go of it. Now notice also that this part of the wing is coming into the web of your fingers, and you can build up. In fact, you can see a little bit of wear and tear here after the contest flying yesterday. But if this area of the wing is sharp, it'll tend to cut that web up pretty bad in your finger. And so this appears to be pretty close to optimum. What's nice about it is you can hold the plane like this, somewhat rigid, with your thumb on the leading edge. And if the pin is further forward, that becomes more difficult to have that control. One of the things you do not want to do with a discus plane is lift it up by the pin. You want to fly the wing up during the launch. And the launch is usually started with the wing in the downwind position. And then as you rotate, the plane tends to fly up on its own all the way around and is released either horizontal or slightly upward. The trend is to release the plane upward more and more, but you have to be very careful about hitting the wingtip on the ground. It causes massive compression failures throughout the wing. So what we want to do is have the wing basically in the downwind position for the start, and I'm using a gyro in this particular airplane, so I have no rudder preset. I have very little elevator preset. My CG is such that I've only got maybe 1 or 2 degrees elevator up preset, and I've got a little bit of reflex on the ailerons. And the launch is basically started with the wing resting on the ground and then swung around and released into the wind. The arm should be extended. The tendency for a lot of people is to make the throw and try and hurry it up. I don't think that you should be working for speed at first. I think you should be working for coordination. And you want to be very careful about pulling your arm in this position of the throw. It tends to flutter the tail surfaces. And in fact, I've seen several stabilizers broken off in that situation. I'll go ahead and do a discus launch here, but just a slow one and a fairly low one.
Here are some different launching styles used by other pilots. Support this free film viewing by visiting my website at radiocarbonart.com and check out my collection of professionally produced how-to and training video programs on building, preparing, and flying today's RC gliders.